Keeping things moving here, our next speaker is Stewart Rhodes. He's the founder and director of Oath Keepers. And I want to just say something personally before I go into his bio. He's one of the people that really inspired me. You know, after Katrina, what our United States government did to the American people was shameful, to say the least. But anyways, I have great passion for the work that Stewart Rhodes does. He did serve in the U.S. Army as a paratrooper until he was disabled in a rough parachuting landing during a night jump. Stewart graduated from the Yale Law School in 2004, where his paper, Solving the Puzzle of Enemy Combatant Status, won Yale's Miller's Prize for Best Paper on Bill of Rights. He's a former firearms instructor and former member of Representative Ron Paul's D.C. staff. Yeah, it says a lot right there. But Stewart currently writes the monthly Enemy at the Gates column for the SWAT magazine. He's assisted in teaching U.S. military history at Yale and was a Yale research scholar and is writing a book on the dangers of applying laws of war to the American people. Give a welcome for Stewart Rhodes.
Hey folks, I'm honored to be here. I want to thank the Ted Nevin Center for inviting Oath Keepers. Their mission is our mission, two peas in the pod, and we look forward to working with them to restore the Republic from the bottom up. And that's what I want to talk to you about right now. How many folks here know about what just happened in Tunisia? You know what happened? After 23 years of living under an oppressive dictator, that had violated their rights, a corrupt government, that had stolen their wealth and oppressed them. They finally got sick of it and got over them. And when they ran them off, guess what the military of Tunisia did? Did they follow orders to shoot the people of Tunisia? No, they did not. The general in charge of the troops refused to fire on the people. But they protested and demanded it. And they demanded that the dictator step down. He refused to fire on the people and stood out of the way. And there were some corrupt allies of the regime in the police who wanted to go ahead and use force on the people. But when the military stepped down, could they do it? No, they could not. And so the people of Tunisia, in a fairly bloodless revolution, got rid of the tyrant because the military stood down. Now, earlier, Michael Bolden asked you people, do you have the courage of the pot smokers in California in defense of your gun rights, in defense of your property rights, in defense of your state sovereignty? Now I'm going to ask you a question myself. Do you have the courage of the Tunisians in standing up for your rights? And I'll ask this question to any person or military police out there. Do you have the honor, integrity, and courage of the Tunisian military? People offended by that question? Good. Prove me correct when I say that I know that my brothers in arms, I served in the Army Airborne, but I know that all my brothers in arms, every branch out there, do have the courage and honor and integrity. But please prove me correct when the time comes. Every generation faces its turn in the barrel. It's time to stand in the breach. This is our time, and I'm glad for it. Better us, as Thomas Paine said, if there is to be trouble, let it come in my day, so that my child may have peace. Amen. Woo! Woo! It's up to us. Because our watch, that's one of the mottos of Oath Keepers, not on our watch. Our republic will not be destroyed on our watch. Every generation has that duty and that charge. How many of you have sworn an oath to support and defend the Constitution of the United States of America against all enemies, foreign and domestic? Raise your hand. Okay. All of us who swore that oath should get down on our knees and beg forgiveness of the American people for our neglect of our duties. Me too, all of us included. We are here in the posture and position we are in right now, which is very much like what the founding fathers faced in the years leading up to the revolution. Many of the same abuses. Go look at the Declaration of Independence. You can see a long list of abuses of their rights that finally caused them, compelled them to rebel. You will find a shopping list for our current government. You will find a list that is scary at how close it is what's happening right now. Denial of jury trial. They were spirited across the seas. That was the extraordinary rendition of their day. They knew they could never convict a notorious smuggler like John Hancock in front of the jury of his peers. And so their answer to that was to not put them in front of the jury of their peers, but take them across the seas and put them in front of an admiralty court. Now, our government today claims a similar authority or power to not try you in front of the jury, but instead to try you in front of a military tribunal if the president so determines you to be an unlawful enemy combatant. Let me ask you a question. What is the constitutional remedy for an American accused of making war against his country or aiding and abetting the enemy? Do you know what it is? A trial for treason. Exactly. As Justice Scalia correctly pointed out in his dissent in the Omni case, the case of a U.S. citizen, he said the proper remedy of the trial for treason that requires a jury trial and two witnesses to the overt act. Extra protection. Because the founders knew and understood from English history, from the Star Chamber on, and what happened to themselves, that the charge of treason is what was levied against someone who was a political opponent of those in power. He knew that power would be abused and used to target political enemies. And so that's why they wrote the treason clause the way they did. Very plain and clear. And Scalia pointed that out. He's like, what are you guys doing? The Supreme Court rubber stamped the claim under the Bush administration that the president, as commander-in-chief, could treat any of you as though you were an Iraqi or an Afghan. No difference between them and us. That's the claim. Did it start with Bush? You think so?
No,
it didn't. It started with Lincoln. He, in the Civil War, didn't just kind of leave his corpus. He also detained 15,000 Northerners who were not in the military, not in the rebellious South. Detained 15,000 of them in military detention. No indictment, no trial. And he tried about 5,000 of them by military tribunal. And the argument from the Winston Supreme Court in 1866, the argument from the lawyers of the Lincoln administration was this to the court. Court, the Bill of Rights and Truth, I say that a lot, the Bill of Rights and Truth are peacetime provisions only and have no effect on the power of the president as commander-in-chief in wartime when the survival of the people is the highest law of the land. That's what he said. The Supreme Court rejected that and said no more pernicious doctrine has ever been invented by the minds of man that the provisions of this Constitution can be set aside in times of war and emergency. So they rejected that gene back in the bottle. It was resurrected by FDR in World War II. Among the things he did, he interned over 100,000 American citizens of Japanese descent. Once again, no indictment, no jury trial. When we're afraid, we tend to give up our liberties and sacrifice them on the altar of security. What did Franklin tell us about that? What was his warning? Those who would give up essential liberty for temporary security shall have neither. He was right. But FDR also did is he claimed the authority to try by military tribunal any American citizen that he deemed to be an unlawful belligerent. And he only tried one like that. He was one of the 8 German saboteurs that came ashore to blow up factories in the United States. One of them was a U.S. citizen, at least at one time. He said, I'm going to go ahead and you know, he should be tried by treason under the Constitution. The president said, I can do what I want under the international laws of war. So he can bring the international laws of war into our country and apply them to the American people. And his executive order asserting his authority was almost exactly like Lincoln's. And then later, when George Bush grabbed a hold of that precedent, or the Bush administration, that executive order was also very much the same. Almost like Lincoln's, almost like FDR's. Very close. So, nothing new under the sun. And here's something most of you don't know. During the Bush administration, there were plenty of people on the political left criticizing his power of president. But they did not say, oh no, you're going to write the jury trial into the content of the treason clause. They said, well, the court has a role to play in this. It was all a separation of powers argument. Congress hasn't given authorization, and the court has the authority to review. And so in the Hamdi case, when the court said, you know, the president's power is not unlimited, this court has no say, they were like, oh, wow, it's a win for the, you know, the Constitution. Nothing of the sort. Because they said, nothing in this Constitution prevents the U.S. government from treating one of its own citizens as unlawful and combatant. That's what they said. But the court will have a special role to play. Like Scalia said, all the court was really doing was taking its own turn. Bell said from now on, but the new standard of due process is you'll get, and it could be a military tribunal. And it really, the modern resurrection didn't really start with Bush. You know where it started? During the Clinton administration. During the Clinton administration, right after the Oklahoma City bombing, two lawyers argued in the Law Review Journal. They said that the president should try to be bailed by military tribunal. And it further said that all the militia movement is actually military enemies of the U.S. government and should be tried by military tribunal. They should be detained and tried like foreign belligerents in wartime. That's what these two lawyers argued. They argued that Clinton should use the powers of commander-in-chief against the militia movement. What do you think would have happened if Clinton had listened to these two idiots and actually had gone and tried to round up the militia movement, put them in military detention and trial by tribunal? What would have happened? Yeah, it would have been another revolution or a civil war. Because the worst nightmare of the militias would have been proven true that Clinton wanted to destroy the Bill of Rights. Now, Clinton didn't listen to that, at least he had, you know, some sense. But the problem is, as the claimed powers, the modern precedents and updating of those claimed powers that these two lawyers urged Clinton to do, that he didn't do, the Bush administration did it. They did update that case law from 1942. They did apply it to the modern war on terror. And they did say it also applies to you if the executive branch thinks you are unlawful combatant. So everything that Clinton didn't have was put in place. And now who's got it? It's like the ring of power from the Lord of the Rings. It's been brought home to Gondor and put on the table there. And it's laying there, it's whispering to Obama and every other president, you know, use me for good. We'll do good together. We'll make change. So he's, you know, if he succumbs to temptation, he has something, he has powers at his fingertips that Bill Clinton could never have dreamed of. And right now, he claims the power and the authority to assassinate American citizens that he thinks are unlawful combatants. He's up the ante. He wouldn't even get a trial. He'll just drop a predator on you. You'll get a hellfire missile from a predator if he so deems necessary. And he claims that his list of citizens that he wants to assassinate is a state secret, that you can't know about it.